Save our water. Keep the money out. Save our water. Keep our land. Save our water. Pipeline out. Save our water. Keep our land. Nothing gained by making deals with the devil. Walk away while you can. Once it's gone forever. Just one chance to stand. Save our water. Keep the money out. Save our water. Keep our land. Save our water. Pipeline out. Save our water. Save our water.
Hi, my name is Jonathan Mark. I produced a film called Moss Brook and TGP, No Fracking Way. This is the poster for considering stopping the pipeline that's planning to go through Massachusetts and New Hampshire by a referendum vote in the Commonwealth of Massachusetts in the 2016 presidential elections. We're going to need quite a few petitions to have this on the ballot, but if we can vote for it and we win, well then they can't do the pipeline because the people have spoken. So why is a referendum a good thing to do? A lot of activists think that we get slaughtered with the parts of the state of Massachusetts that's not being directly affected by this pipeline. Why would they vote to say no to new infrastructure for fossil fuels? Well, there's a lot of good reasons, and that pertains to everybody. Sure, they have gas pipelines in the ground near them, but do we need more? And do we need to invest in infrastructure that will be depleted within 20, 30, 40 years at the most? And then investing in solar, there's so much more of an upside because we'd be lowering the price eventually as we commit to using this natural fuel that's everywhere. We wouldn't have to pollute the earth and the water by attaining it. And we'd be able to export that type of technologies that would come out of sustainable fuels, renewable fuels, that would just give us a better chance to have peace and harmony within our nation and other nations. But of course they'll say, you can't do that, we have to have these bridge technologies, that's why we're going to frack as much as we can and export it. No, that's not true. That's the military industrial commander-in-chief saying what the forces that have control over him say. And whatever the election happens in 2016, it's going to be the same situation where the military-industrial complex will be able to maintain power and control. Since they killed John F. Kennedy, every president has to maintain and withhold files of the investigations of that murder. It's something that a lot of people can't fathom, that there could be such a big event and the media would all go along with it and so many people would believe it or even forget about it and say, yes, it did happen, there's nothing we can do and we're going to go on. Whatever we go on from a lie, and we build our foundations of our nation based on corruption and distortion, we're not going to succeed in any of our policies. So the referendum enables, Massachusetts is one of 24 states that is allowed to make direct laws from public referendums. And popular votes and trusting the majority of people, I say, is a much better choice than trusting the money-bought leadership that is controlling Congress and the White House. Even though a lot of people are controlled too by the media systems that tell them what to think and believe and what we need, we can counteract that through internet, through the grassroots movements, if we have enough united forces and insight to say the fossil fuel age is over. Moss Brook can get pretty quiet in the winter time and it's covered over with ice and snow. Part of it remains though. Always the movement, the flow of water is different than the flow of gas. The flow of gas in a frack-gas pipeline that's 36 inches wide in diameter needs a lot of pressure. And so they build these humongous compressor stations. And that does damage to a town that doesn't need any more new infrastructure for fossil fuels. And it could danger the water.
This is an aerial view of the compressor station from Springfield, Pennsylvania. So basically, a long and natural gas pipeline, every 30 to 70 miles, they need to compress the gas to move it down the pipe. And this particular pipeline will be at pressures up to 1460 psi.
In these infrared videos, a very expensive camera sees what the human eye cannot.
Whenever you sweep an area to look for a gas leak, you can be 2 foot from it and miss it. So in other words, if you were gonna do some welding in that area in a plant, and you go out and you sweep the area, and you were 2 foot from actually where the plume was, then all of a sudden you've got gas in the air if you don't know it. So if you're cutting, welding, or whatever you're doing, something, you know, that might shoot some sparks out, if it gets outside of where you swell, then you could have a potential fire.
Compressor stations are prone to leaks, and harmful, volatile organic compounds are merely vented into the atmosphere. Health issues are becoming more evident in the older gas fields. In some cases, children and adults living and working near gas well and processing sites suffer from nosebleeds and endocrine disruption. When the symptoms show, it's too late. Natural gas can condense into liquid form within the pipeline. This liquid may contain benzene, toluene, xylene, mercury, chromium-6, and radium-226. The condensate may additionally contain PCB-contaminated lubricants that entered the pipeline and are removed at the site. Compressor stations run 24 hours a day and introduce noise levels to the environment regardless of how they are powered. Sometimes explosions occur at compressor stations and along the pipeline because of human error and natural disasters. The results are devastating.
First developing now, a natural gas explosion in the northern part of Texas.
We're hovering about 3/4 of a mile away from this fire.
The explosion was so big, the chaos was so bad, the numbers all afternoon were across the board. The only person missing is the person who was actually driving that heavy equipment. It was a 36-inch pipe with high-pressure natural gas.
In their research report, they say this would be an 80,000 horsepower compressor station. That would include 3 different turbines. This is a picture of what one of them looks like. That's the factory model. Just so you know, I could not find a single picture of an 80,000 horsepower compressor station because there aren't very many of them compared with smaller compressor stations. But this is a graph of sizes of compressor stations. Ours would fall in here. In fact, Kinder Morgan couldn't even find a picture of one. This is the slide they gave to our select board. In August, this is a 2,000 horsepower compressor station, 40 times smaller than the one they're proposing. And on the left, there are pictures of valve stations. You can see the pipe in that picture is maybe 6 inches in diameter compared with the 36-inch pipe that they're proposing here. So I just, along the way, we've continually been sort of misled by Kinder Morgan. In their research report that came out in December, they say a compressor station would take 20 acres to construct and 10 acres to permanently operate. When they previously had their earlier research report, there was a compressor station to be sited in Deerfield, They said that that would take 50 to 75 acres, so something's not translating. And here's a picture of a different company's compressor station. It's a 21,000 horsepower, so about a quarter of the size, currently occupying 60 acres. Here, I have a few more pictures. Most of these are smaller, about 20,000 horsepower. If you try to look at one of the semi-trucks, you can get a size for scale.
So where are they going to put the pipeline? Well, this is in the direction of northwest. And from where I am, just below Mount Craig in Northfield. And the compressor station is going to be in this area. Here's all the surrounding land where the compressor station will be pumping out pressurized frack gas, as if we needed it, but we really don't. And they really can't put it right along the lines, since there's a danger of spark and explosions, but it'll be near it, near these power lines, so they can say they're using right-of-ways in the wrong way. So around these power lines that people have to live with, we'll have a new source of pollution possible. It'll be sound pollution, air pollution, and climate change pollution.
This is a four-unit compression station owned by Cabot, about 5 miles from the top-bottom chief gas compressor. This unit is turned on, as you can hear. And this is a four-unit compressor.
Shift has got to hit. gases pass, we point a finger, we blame the dog. The blame is self-defeating, cause all of us are overeating, co-creating all kinds of smog. Yeah, it reeks, let's raise a stink, but deep beneath the brain, we know the ones who smelt it, all the ones who dealt it. We all abuse eminent domain. I pray that we can
wake up and smell the gas, or slip into permanent sleep. The shift has got to hit the fan, or the wolf is gonna eat the sheep. Wake up,
wake up,
wake up.
Just recently, I interviewed some neighbors in Winchester, New Hampshire. Now that Moss Brook is off the hook because Kinder Morgan changed their preferred route, they're now going up to Winchester, New Hampshire from Northfield after the horrible compressor station, which could be in the earshot of Moss Brook. It will certainly take away a view of Mount Craig to the west, where you'll see a scar of 50 feet to 100 feet going along this big line all the way from New York State into New Hampshire and then back down to Massachusetts and Drake it.
So the pipeline is proposed to cross this valley about a half mile south of where we're standing. It would dissect this prime agricultural land, which is lake bottom from Lake Hitchcock back in the post-glacial era. It would come off of this ridgeline over here to my right and cross a tree farm up at the highest point of this ridge of pine trees that you see above us over here.
Yeah.
And from there across this valley, and if we can turn the camera around all the way around into the woods, this is at the beginning of a huge area of wetland that goes either side of what we call Myrie Brook. And Myrie Brook comes the full length of this valley from the base of Mount Grace. And actually, there's a brook that comes from the town of Warwick right down through the state park and the former picnic area up there in the gulf leading where Route 78 goes up into Warwick. And that brook comes right through this valley. If you turn all the way around here, you can see the bridge where it goes under that bridge. And from here, it's about a mile and a half to where it enters the Ashuelot River right by Routes 10 and 119 going into Winchester. But there's acres and acres of wetland here on what used to be the lake bottom, and gradually silted in over millions of years to establish this prime agricultural land, which has been farmed continuously since the 1700s. The barn that you see in the distance over here, the original barn on that site was built in 1790, along with the homestead. There's a series of houses down this valley that were built in that era, the 1790s. Well, as I was saying, imagine looking up there and seeing a 100-foot wide swath where there's no trees, and there never will be ever again, as long as the pipeline is operational and before they becomes eventually in a few decades obsolete and they just leave it sitting in the ground to rust.
Yeah. Well, you think we'll stop them, or you're hoping that they move from the most...
my hope is that they leave that fracking stuff in the ground in Pennsylvania. It took millions of years for the ecosystem to sequester all that carbon in the earth, and here in 2 centuries we propose to burn it all and send it into the atmosphere and cause irreparable global warming damage to the planet. That's where I come from. It should stop right there. in terms of the need for the pipeline, it's a manufactured need. Mr. Kinder has to park his billions somewhere that he raped the state of California when he was working for Enron. So he wants to just do some more raping across the country.
Yeah, because this gas is not going to serve this area.
Ha! No, you'll never see home-to-home distribution of natural gas in the valley like this. Impossible. They just want to get it out to areas of what they presume to be future growth of industry and even important to the various Atlantic ports, the one in Beverly, Massachusetts, the one up in New Brunswick, etc. Now it's unnecessary, it's unneeded, it's a travesty, it's raping the countryside. If we can stop it, we will.
I hope so. Thank you.
I just wanted to read something that was published in the paper by an article by Hattie Netzel. One might say that we need natural gas to meet energy needs in Massachusetts. However, Deerfield resident David Keith, an independent energy researcher and author, notes the 2.2 billion cubic feet of gas per day that this pipeline would move through our state is double the amount of gas we now consume. Keith stated in his January 3rd My Turn column in the Recorder in the Greenfield newspaper that 2.2 billion cubic feet of gas per day is enough to produce 20 times the average output of the now closed Vermont Yankee nuclear power plant. Using conservative conversion factors that includes energy loss and power generation, the pipeline will deliver enough fuel to produce more than twice the combined power generated in all of New England by coal, petroleum, and nuclear fuels in 2012. Consensus is that gas carried by the proposed pipeline would be liquefied and exported to Europe through the Port of St. John in New Brunswick, Canada. Prices in Europe are much higher than here, and then, therefore, the profit Kinder Morgan would reap would be on the backs of the people of Massachusetts and New Hampshire, who would be taxed to pay for the pipeline on the grounds that the pipeline would be constructed for the public good in order to provide sufficient natural gas to fuel Massachusetts' energy needs. And that's the Northeast Direct NED project. And obviously, that much gas is not for Massachusetts. And so the exporting of it is not for our interest. It may be for geopolitical purposes, and it would reduce the cost of energy overall, but that would be a hindrance for renewable energy that would be cleaner and not tax us all by out-of-control climate change, pollution, accidents, pollution of our water systems, earthquakes that the fracking causes, and the droughts. So we have a choice here, and I hope Massachusetts residents get the chance to vote in 2016 to stop new infrastructure for fossil fuels. The fossil fuel age is over, hopefully, in this state, as new infrastructure would only be for clean and renewable energy systems. I'm not sure if we're going to get enough petitioners to create this referendum. We have till August to register with the Attorney General's office in 2015 to be on the ballot in 2016. And we've been reaching out to many people that would have enough funds to help us hire the professional petition gatherers that would have to be spread out throughout the state, and especially in Boston, and to require to receive almost 80,000 signatures in just in a few months' time. The other way to go is to get an organization like the Sierra Club. They have workers that can take on those petitions, and they could help educate. And then the the proposal for the grassroots activists in Massachusetts, especially those directly affected by the pipeline, then to be reach out all across the state, go to town meetings, go in places where they don't know, you know, how this would tax them, how they don't know how this would be a major shift in the balance of our climate and our renewable energy systems that would be much more prosperous for the people of Massachusetts and not lower our property values by putting poison and toxic fuels that can explode and pollute and methane and add to the greenhouse gases. I did get a positive response from the director of the Massachusetts chapter director of the Sierra Club. Emily Norton wrote, "Thank you for your email and this terrific idea. I started as chapter director a couple of weeks ago, so I have been getting up to speed on numerous issues, including the pipeline proposal. I know one of our executive committee members has been very engaged in it, so I will check in with him and then circle back with you. I look forward to working with you and bringing the heft of the Mass Sierra Club to bear in this fight." And I think we can recruit the New Hampshire chapter as well to support us, because if we can block the pipeline in Massachusetts, then New Hampshire will be protected, because there's no pipeline that will be allowed to go through from Vermont. And New York has stopped fracking, and we want to send a big message, not just for the places in the path or near the path of the pipeline, but for all of us, globally, nationally, and personally. Thank you for listening to this program, and have a good day.
There was a knock one morning. A man was standing at my door. He said, "Hello, I'm from Halliburton. Have you heard of us before? We'd like to lease your backyard to drill for natural gas. It's called hydraulic fracturing, and it is the very pass for a clean energy future above the Marcellus Stone. Plus, we'll give you lots of money and a new mobile phone." I said, "You are a corporate crook. I don't believe the things you tell, and you can drive right off my property and then go straight to hell. No fracking way. No fracking way. I don't trust corporate salesmen, whatever they may say. No fracking way. No fracking way. No fracking way." My neighbor was out of work and things were looking grim, so when the fracking guy came knocking, he had better luck with him. The company said, "Don't worry, everything will just be fine, so just sign your name right here, sir, on this dotted line." Pretty soon the water was tasting pretty dire. One day I lit a match and the water caught on fire. I thought about a lawsuit, then stumbled upon the fact that fracking is exempted from the Clean Water Act. No fracking way. No fracking way. Is this how democracy works here in the USA? No fracking way. No fracking way. No fracking way. As if the situation weren't sufficiently unattractive, we tested the water and found it was radioactive. Now my property is worthless and there's a tumor in my brain. Half of my neighbors are sick, the rest are just in pain. Maybe I should take the money, move off to live somewhere, but all the places I look at, they're fracking there. Our choices now are simple: lose that which we hold dear, or communicate the message in a way that's unstoppably clear. No fracking way. No fracking way. Tell these frackers to frack off both tomorrow and today. No fracking way. No fracking way. No fracking way. No fracking way. No fracking way.
Hi, my name is Jonathan Mark. I'm with Flyby News, flybynews.com, an online internet website that's been around since the 1990s. We started off with 1997 to expose a high-risk flyby of Earth by the Cassini space probe. We learned this from Professor Carl Grossman that explained how the military was taking over space, and we wanted to end the arms race. So right after the Cassini flyby, we aimed to stop weapons from entering outer space. But going back again to the Cassini flyby, I received a really interesting call from someone that was challenging, to say the least. He was saying that humans were very advanced in pre-Ice Age times, and he wanted to comment on the Cassini because of all the plutonium it was using on board, 72.3 pounds of highly radioactive plutonium. You can learn all about the Cassini flyby at flybynews.com and our special guest, Bart Jordan, who's here now in Dover, New Hampshire, and we're going to be asking him to explain a lot of things that he wrote during the commentary of the Cassini, plus recent discoveries and much, much more. Thanks for coming, Bart, and having me here. And now I'm going to let you maybe introduce yourself. What would you say about yourself to someone asking you, knowing that you're involved with pre-Ice Age civilizations, and how did you get into it? What did you learn, and what's your message?
Well, first of all, I'm very happy to be here, and I'm happy that you were the one who initiated that by virtue of what you reported. I think that where it starts for me, actually, is when I'm about 5 years old, my grandfather, my mother's father, started to interest me in looking at language as a science rather than just as something you learn in order to communicate on the everyday. And the reason for that was he, well, I asked him a question, first of all. He had a huge shortwave radio. I think he could hear the chattering of the monkeys in Zamboanga that have no tails. I'm not sure, but he could pick up everything, and he was able, like his mother, to negotiate his way with about 10 languages. So he listened throughout the time to advents and events that were connected with the war in progress. Because, of course, it hit in 41 for us, right. But it had started in Europe before that time.
Okay.
And I wanted to learn the family languages, which essentially were German on one side and French on the other, and my grandfather said no. And I was a little stunned by the statement, but at the same time, brief as it was, I thought, well, there must be something in the top of his mind. And it was that I should learn ancient languages before modern ones would become too much of a focus for me. So he said the oldest language in the world, of which there is a scientific root for, is Greek. I expected him to say Sanskrit or something, or Sumerian or something, because I knew he had a vast amount of knowledge. But he didn't. He said Greek. And so I said, okay, well, we'll begin there. So before the year was out, I was 5 years old, I deciphered the music notation of ancient Greece. And it was all based on a particular gravestone that was in what would be ancient Tralles, but modern Edin in Turkey. It was found by Ramsey, archaeologist and whatnot, but it was the only complete anything that gave a text and the music line above that text. And indeed it was Greek. That was understandable because it was probably put there around the 1st century AD. That's very late in the day. But at least it would be, looking back, an eclectic work, looking back on something that was developed much earlier, in the idea of the language actually being a way to conduct one through music that had a cosmological connection. In other words, one that was based on the movement of the planets and so on.
Okay.
So I became very interested in that, and at the same time, I had in my mind an image that I had received in a dream, and I can show you that image. It is essentially a raindrop, but the colors represent red for south in summer, orange for west in autumn, green for east in spring, and blue for north in winter. It also was father, son, daughter, mother. And the image in between was a dove descending, and you can see the fuselage in effect of the body of the dove and then the wings on either side. Well, I became very interested in what it was doing and why it was doing, why it was that shape. And I realized after time that it sort of followed a yin-yang aspect of one at the north, two at northeast, three at east, and four at southeast. And then it had to cross the zenith or the center and go up here and have five at the northwest, and then six at west, seven at southwest, and eight finally at the bottom. Now, this meant that 1, 2, 3, 4 across the line in the center, 5, 6, 7, 8 was the perfect origin of yin yang. That was very clear. Not only that, but you had the opposition of 1 opposite 8, 2 opposite 7, 3 opposite 6, and 4 opposite 5, all nines in every case. So then I realized, okay, then this must be the dove descending that represents Venus, or Aphrodite. My family always said, as did most everyone else, Aphrodite. And of course, when I knew the Greek to be Aphrodite, I said to myself, oh, Aphrodite without her mighty? But I didn't dare say that too often. Anyway, it was interesting because the 1 times the 2 times the 5 times the 8 was 80. This portion here was 80. And then 3 times the 4 times 6 times 7 was 504 with the wings. And that was a total of 584. And that is the number of days it takes for Venus to come back in the same place in the sky. Synodical revolution.
From the Earth?
Yes. From the Earth forming conjunction with the Sun, yes. So it's actually 583.921. But if you're not splitting hairs, it is, or picking pepper out of something.
Well, were you splitting hairs when you were 5 years old?
Well, I didn't really intend to split hairs. I was trying to discover why it was that the Greeks had one view of the average number for the average person, and then had a scientific reading that was a bit more critical.
Right.
And so that kind of thing interested me very much.
Okay, wait, how did that interest you? You're 5 years old. You must have had a sort of a feeling for science.
Oh, yes.
And what generated that? Just, was it natural? Was your family? Or?
Well, I think first of all, my grandfather had a very unusual library, very unusual to say the least. Many subjects, and not a few of them were science-oriented. So I was very interested in astronomy, and I knew that I had a visual impairment, so I didn't try to use telescopes so much as I tried to project what was out there. Sometimes I got it right, sometimes I got it wrong, but you know, I worked at it. Anyway, this image, it was interesting because once I had drawn it, and mind you, you're looking at something here which is a photograph of a watercolor, but I had originally done it in pencil and crayon. Later, my grandfather, seeing it, said, I'll give you some tools to do it properly. So that's what you see, the result. And I had some beautiful acrylics that I made of this and other things that you will see. And it took months and months and months to do those, and it took actually over a series of years to do all of it. And unfortunately, it was destroyed on one day, 27th of October, 2004, when where I live in public housing, they moved my apartment from my 103 to 303, where I reside today. claiming that mold was in everything and therefore they had to destroy it. Well, they didn't, because that's not actually what happened at all. But they did so, and of course I've been trying to dig my way out of that hole ever since.
Partly the reason why all those things that you said you were going to publish after the Cassini flyby had been delayed?
That's correct. That's correct. I was actually only about maybe 6 months at the most away from publishing a series of articles which had been gathered together as a book. Mm-hmm. And
Was that the alphabet in the string?
Well, that was a separate article, but yes, it would have been included. But the basic book was Deciphering the Distant Past, just as the same as the article that was here in the Public Occurrences paper. This is where it started. The Dakota, the Lakota, and the Nakota. And everybody can hear that. The Kota is the only thing that remains the same. But it was a thing which was sort of a call to the moment of what my grandfather had spoken of. The fact that the language was so old and the alphabetic structure so entirely old that it probably was pretty much stretched across the globe as we know it to be. And it was not surprising to find Amerindian peoples with a full knowledge of the sound order of the Greek alphabet. It was a shock for linguists, I'm sure, because they didn't expect it, any more than they would expect a far-reaching relationship between the ancient Greeks, and we're talking about something that was even pre-Homeric, to be in China, amongst the Shang. But it's Shang Dynasty. But there were many images that I was able to reconstruct from the Shang period in terms of the origin of the characters in Chinese that were ordered exactly the same, and in fact, ironically, one of them identically to this, except that they don't use the outer lines, they use the inner lines. And so the image for Xing today would be in Chinese a star. And of course, what is Venus but the great star? Yeah. So it's quite understandable, Dai Xing. So anyway, I can tell you that the Shang presented a particular interest for me when I looked into it, because again, my grandfather had these things, you know, in his library, and I was able to borrow and discover for myself. Plus, I had Chinese friends, and that was also very helpful, because they were my own age, and of course, they chattered back and forth in Chinese, and I just had to know what was going on. So the Shang actually took their name, and probably it was a given by the Greek, because the thing is, you have a sigma followed by an eta, followed by an alpha, followed by a nu, followed by a gamma. That spells out Shang in any way you want to look at it. And the thing is, it adds to, with each letter in Greek being a number, it adds to 262. Well, now, even today in Chinese, the sign that you see on all Chinese laundries, all Chinese restaurants, all Chinese anything, the sign for the middle people of the earth, it doesn't refer to the middle in the sense of the equator, but rather the middle of the tilt that goes from either north or west to southeast or northeast to southwest. And that tilt is at a 45, conveniently. And the interesting thing about that is when the Greeks did their original size of the earth, they did it according to, I know I'm going to get in trouble with this, but the foot, the so-called English or British foot. And of course, it's not some great royal brute of Britain putting his foot down saying, that's my foot. That's total rubbish.
You're saying this measurement was way back?
Yes, it was way, way back. It was in the Ice Age. It was fairly clear. But the thing was that Shang was very interesting because it reflects exactly what is the character in Chinese to this day. It's not a Shang character, but I mean, it's coming from that same source. Now, why middle? Middle people of the earth. Well, you know, everybody wants to be the center of attention, they say, but in this case, it's that the Greeks had devised a middle position where the actual number that applied to the measurement of the earth was 131,262,131 feet. Now, that was the middle measure on either tilt side, which gave you an understanding of, therefore, with 131 as outriggers on either side of the 262, what is it? It's 262 by half. They fold it out. So it was brilliant. Now, what about the equatorial measure? Well, the 131s were still on the outside, but the one in the middle, the monkey in the middle, was 484. And so, what about the polar? Well, that was 040. So they were all palindromic. That's the point.
Why would it be in palindromic? I mean, you're saying it's very symmetrical.
That's the whole point. It reads the same from the right as from the left.
Well, why is it like? Tell me, why do you think so many of these numbers have this aspect of symmetry to it?
Well, because they looked upon the whole thing sort of like a resonating string, and the musical string, and they wanted to make it clear that things had a reciprocal resonance by virtue of their construction. Either it was right in front of your face, or it was something that was derived by virtue of a mathematical operation. That's why the word shang, for example, not only means merchant, but it also means quotient. But in the case of shang, that's understandable that they would have had cooperative scientific work that was done. This is also true of the Indus Valley, because these are very ancient cultures as well. This is true of Sumeria. And I think I fairly shocked Samuel Noah Kramer many, many moons later than what my grandfather and I had worked together by appearing down there at University of Pennsylvania under the aegis of one Schuyler Kamen, who had been former director of the University of Pennsylvania Museum in Philadelphia. And he told Samuel Noah Kramer, he said, give him words from the Sumerian that he couldn't possibly know and ask him if he can determine the meaning from the sound. So I got 8 out of 10. And the reason I didn't get the others, in part, is because the transliteration of that sound was not accurate. And so I couldn't do with anything with that. But he did express surprise. So he said, what you're telling me by this demonstration is that Greek is older. As a language form, it's older than Sumerian. And I said, well, Dr. Kramer, I mean, that's a foregone conclusion. It has to be, you know. And then I proceeded to show him a number of other things in terms of the ceilings which had not been properly identified. And he began to see, oh, then this is actually something that may be not only older, but better organized than anything that we have thought of thus far. And I said, yeah, that's the whole point. It's the organization which is so staggering and brilliant.